Hallelujah and blessings in Jesus, friends. Welcome back to Hayakadosh Ministries, where holiness is a way of life. Jesus is truly King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and the Holy Bible is our only standard and authority for truth. And together God's people say with hearts of gratefulness, Hallelujah. Well, friends, today we are continuing our study on the classic by Andrew Murray, which is called Humility, subtitled The Journey Toward Holiness. Well, we're going to continue where we last left off, and that means that we'll pick up in chapter 12 today, which is titled Humility and Exaltation. F.B. Meyer once said, I used to think that God's gifts were on shelves, one above another, and the taller we grow, the easier we can reach them. Now I find, however, that God's gifts are on shelves, but the lower we stoop, the more we get. Luke chapter 14, verse 11, and chapter 18, verse 14 says, He who humbles himself will be exalted. James chapter 4, verses 6 and 10 say that God gives grace to the humble. So humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will lift you up. And 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 6 says, Humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time. Recently, I was asked the question, How can I overcome my pride? The answer is simple. Two things are needed. Do what God says to do, which is to humble yourself, and trust him to do what he says he will do, which is to exalt you. The command is clear, but to humble yourself does not mean that you must conquer and cast out the pride of your nature and then form within yourself the lowliness of Jesus. No, that is God's work. He lifts you up into the true likeness of his beloved Son. What the command does mean is this: take every opportunity to humble yourself before God and man in the faith of the grace that is already working in you, in the assurance of the grace for the victory that is yet to be, stand persistently under the unchanging command, humble yourself. Accept with gratitude everything that God allows from within or without, from friend or enemy, in nature or in grace. Let it remind you of your need for humbling and to help you in it. Reckon humility to be the mother virtue, your very first duty before God, the one perpetual safeguard of the soul, and set your heart upon it as the source of all blessing. The promise is divine and sure. He that humbles himself shall be exalted. See that you do the one thing that God asks, and he will see that he does the one thing he has promised. He will give more grace. He will exalt you in due time. All God's dealings with man are characterized by two stages. There is the time of preparation, when command and promise, with the mingled experience of effort and impotence, of failure and partial success, with the holy expectancy of something better, that these waken, they train and discipline men for a higher stage. Then will come the time of fulfillment, when faith inherits the promise and enjoys what it had so often struggled for in vain. This law holds good in every part of the Christian life and in the pursuit of every separate virtue. And that is because it is grounded in the very nature of things. In all that concerns our redemption, God must take the initiative. When that has been done, it is now man's turn. In the effort after obedience and attainment, he must learn to know his powerlessness. In self-despair, he must learn to die to himself, and so be fitted voluntarily and intelligently to receive from God the end, the completion of that which he had accepted in the beginning in ignorance. So God, who had been the beginning before man rightly knew him or fully understood what his purpose was, is longed for and welcomed as the end, as the all in all. It is so too in the pursuit of humility. To every Christian, the command comes from the throne of God Himself. Humble yourself. The earnest attempt to listen and obey will be rewarded with the painful discovery of two things: the depth of our pride and the powerlessness of all our efforts to destroy it. Blessed is the man who has learned to put his hope in God. We know the law of human nature. Acts produce habits. Habits breed dispositions. Dispositions form the will, and the rightly formed will becomes the character. It is no different in the work of grace. As acts, persistently repeated as they are, they beget habits and dispositions, and these strengthen the will. He who works both to will and to do in us comes with his mighty power and spirit, and the humbling of the proud heart with which the penitent saint so often casts himself before God is rewarded with the more grace of the humble heart. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, friends, and he will exalt you. It cannot be repeated too often. The highest glory of the creature is in being a vessel to receive and enjoy and show forth the glory of God. It can only do this as it is willing to be nothing in itself, that God may be everything. Water always fills first the lowest places. The lower, the emptier a man lies before God, the speedier and the fuller will be the inflow of the divine glory. Let me repeat that. Water always first fills the lowest places. The lower, the emptier a man lies before God, the speedier and the fuller will be the inflow of the divine glory. The exaltation God promises is not, cannot be, any external thing apart from himself. All that he has to give or can give is only more of himself, in order that he might take the more complete possession. The exaltation is not, like an earthly prize, something arbitrary and in no connection with the conduct to be rewarded. It is, in its very nature, the effect and result of the humbling of ourselves. It is nothing but the gift of such a divine indwelling humility, such a conformity to and possession of the humility of the Lamb of God, as fits us for receiving fully the indwelling of God. He that humbles himself shall be exalted. Of the truth of these words, Jesus himself is the proof. Of the certainty of their fulfillment to us, he is the pledge. Let us take his yoke upon us and learn of him, for he is meek and lowly of heart. If we are but willing to stoop to him, as he has stooped to us, he will yet stoop to each one of us again, and we shall find ourselves not unequally yoked with him. As we enter deeper into the fellowship of his humiliation, and either humble ourselves or bear the humbling of men, we can count upon the fact that the spirit of his exaltation, the spirit of God and of glory, will rest upon us. The presence and the power of the glorified Christ will come to them that are of a humble spirit. When God can again have his rightful place in us, he will lift us up. Make his glory your motivation to humble yourself. He will make your glory his motivation to perfect your humility. As the all-pervading life of God possesses you, there will be nothing so natural, nothing so sweet as to be nothing, with no thought or wish for self, because all is occupied with him alone. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9 says, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses, so that Christ's power may rest upon me. Have we not here the reason that our consecration and our faith have availed so little in the pursuit of holiness? It was by self and its strength that the work was done under the name of faith. It was for self and its happiness that God was called in. It was unconsciously, but still truly, in self and its holiness that the soul rejoiced. We never knew that humility, absolute, abiding, Christ-like humility, and self-effacement pervading and marking our whole life with God and man was the most essential element of the life of holiness for which we sought. It is only in the possession of God that I lose myself. As it is the height and breadth and glory of the sunshine that the smallest speck dancing in its beams is seen, even so humility is taking our place in God's presence to be nothing but a speck dancing in the sunlight of His love. How great is our God! How small we are! Lost, swallowed up in love's immensity. May God teach us to believe that to be humble, to be nothing in His presence, is the highest attainment and the fullest blessing of the Christian life. He speaks to us in Isaiah chapter 57, verse 15, when He says, I live in a high and holy place, but also with him who is contrite and lowly in spirit. In understanding this, let us sing together with the writer of the old hymn when he says, oh, to be emptier, lowlier, hidden, unnoticed, and unknown, and to God a vessel holier, filled with Christ, and Christ alone. Our study now comes to a close, friend, and we'll end by the final chapter, which is titled, A Prayer for Humility. The secret of secrets is this: humility is the soul of true prayer. Until the spirit of the heart is renewed, until it is emptied of all earthly desires and stands in a habitual hunger and thirst after God, which is the true spirit of prayer, until then, all our prayer will be more or less like lessons given to students. We will mostly say them only because we dare not neglect them. But be not discouraged. Take the following advice, and then you may go to church without any danger of mere lip service or hypocrisy, although there may be a hymn or a prayer whose language is higher than that of your heart. Go to the church as the tax collector went to the temple. Stand inwardly in the spirit of your mind, in that form that he outwardly expressed when he cast down his eyes, and all he could say was, God be merciful to me, a sinner. Stand unchangeably, at least in your desire. In this form or state of heart, it will sanctify every petition that comes out of your mouth. And when anything is read or sung or prayed that is more exalted than your heart is, if you make this an occasion of further identifying with the spirit of the tax collector, you will then be helped and highly blessed by those prayers and by those praises that seem to belong to a heart better than yours. This, my friend, is the secret of secrets. It will help you to reap where you have not sown, and it will be a continual source of grace in your soul. For everything that inwardly stirs in you or outwardly happens to you becomes good to you if it finds you in this humble state of mind. For nothing is in vain or without profit to the humble soul. It stands always in a state of divine growth, and everything that falls upon it is like dew from heaven. Close yourself, therefore, in this form of humility. All good is enclosed in it. It is a fresh spring from heaven that turns the fire of the fallen soul into the meekness of the divine life and creates that oil out of which the love to God and man gets its flame. Be always clothed in it, friends. Let it be as a garment wherewith you are always covered and a shield in which you are girded. Breathe nothing but in and from its spirit. See nothing but with its eyes, hear nothing but with its ears. And then, whether you are in the church or out of the church, hearing the praises of God or receiving wrongs from men and the world, all will be edification, and everything will help promote your growth in the life of God. I will here give you an infallible touchstone that will test all to the truth. Retire from the world and all conversation for 1 month. Neither write nor read, nor debate anything with yourself. Stop all the former workings of your heart and your mind, and with all the strength of your heart, stand as continually as you can in the following form of prayer to God. Offer it frequently on your knees, but whether sitting, walking, or standing, be always inwardly longing and earnestly praying this one prayer to God, that of His great goodness He would make known to you, and take from your heart every kind and form and degree of pride, whether it be from evil spirits or your own corrupt nature, and that He would awaken in you the deepest depth and truth of that humility which can make you capable of His light and Holy Spirit. Reject every thought but that of waiting and praying in this manner from the bottom of your heart, with such truth and earnestness as people in agony pray and are delivered from their torment. In this spirit of prayer, I will venture to affirm that if you had twice as many evil spirits in you as Mary Magdalene had, they would all be cast out of you, and you would be forced with her to weep tears of love at the feet of the Holy Jesus. Friend, I trust that you have been blessed, challenged, and moved deeply by this study in a most important topic, that of humility. I ask the Lord Jesus that you will not take what you have heard through this study lightly, but it will become the focal point of your mind, and that you would seek it with the persistence and desperation that a drowning man would seek his last breath of air. In our next time together, friends, we will begin a new study on another tiny book, yet a very great book by Andrew Murray, which is titled Absolute Surrender, which obviously and of course would be the next step in our journey as we began on the road to Calvary, stepped into the valley of humility, and next we will ascend the hill of absolute surrender. Now, as the Father Yahweh, His Son the Lord Jesus, and His Spirit the Holy Ghost so wills, I truly love you, friends, and I'll see you on the next video.